Hello and welcome to another Vintage Cube, the final Vintage Cube of the season. Time Spiral Remastered comes out in a few hours' time, so I assume at the update Vintage Cube will be gone and we won't have any more of it. But this is Vintage Cube. I'm Vince, also known as Pleasant Kenobi on the internet. Vintage Cube is powered cube, so is power. We've opened zero power in pack one. Pick one now. What are we going to take? Deceiver Exarch opens us up to Twin. Thousand Year Storm opens us up to a deck that will be awful. Umboreal Rites is one of the weak reanimation spells. Boundless Citadel is a pretty good Tinker target. And a Storm payoff. Karakas and Probe are both reasonable. Memory Jar is a draw 7 for those sort of decks that want draw 7s, your combo decks. And Hell Rider is a pretty strong 4 drop if we can get a creature based mono red deck on the go. I'm tempted to take Citadel or Exarch. I'm going to take Exarch. Exarch's safer. Citadel's more fun, I think, but sometimes you got to play it safe. Next up, we got Valky, God of Ruining Formats. Is that any good in this format? Two modes is good. Golos, which goes and gets you any old thing from Shrines of Nykthos to Talarian Academies to Gaia's Cradles. So I'm quite a big fan of Golos. I think it's between Golos and Baleful Strix in terms of like playing roles, but I think I like Golos. Keeps us nice and safe, keeps us open for blue. Next pack, we have Reanimation Target and Shouldred, big mana and cheaty target in terms of Ulamog. We've got a premium mana dork, a Scalding Tarn, and a Gush. Eternal Witness is also a pretty strong card. Any regrowth effect is good in Vintage Cube. And Dark Petition is a tutor, but an expensive tutor that's better in the spell-based combo decks. I guess Angath Rampage is probably better than I give it credit for, but I never end up playing it. I'm going to take the Tarn. Quite an easy pick. Next up, the Tarn can fetch us a Taker or a Breeding Pool, which both factor in to what we're doing here in terms of, well, being blue and playing other cards. Academy Ruins is good if we're in the artifact deck, as is Emery. Emery can obviously allow us to play cards from our graveyard, which is value. There's also an Entomb here. And Primetime as well. Primetime is Primetime. I think this is a hard pack because we have two premium bits of fixing and Primetime. I'm also quite heavily on the train of Emery because I haven't drafted an artifact deck this cube yet. You know, a Talarian Academy, Goblin Welder style deck. But I'm going to take Primetime. It doesn't mean we're in green, but it's a pretty good green card, so we could not take it, right? Scalding Tarn can't fetch the Goddess Shrine. Seachrome Coast doesn't fix us for any of the cards you picked thus far. So what is objectively very powerful here? Thieving Skydiver can steal other people's Moxes and Soul Rings. Yeah, I think Thieving Skydiver is pretty strong. Next up, we're looking for Twin, right? Don't forget Twin is a primo pick for us. Imperial Recruiter is power tool. As Imperial Recruiter can go get the Exarch and the Thieving Skydiver right now. Having bits that shoot off your Twin combo is pretty strong. Beyond that, I do like Dorks. A Pack Rat is obviously very strong, but not as strong as Vintage Cube. Niv, if you build around, is pretty good. Passing Flame is a Storm card. Mana Flare is a trap or a Storm card. Reanimate a spell. Mana Doubler. I'm taking Imperial Recruiter. Again, we're not married to where we're at now. Okay, I'm pretty hot on taking Signets. Looting would be a consideration if we had Emery. Obviously, Goblin Welder would be as well. I think we take the Signet. I am quite hot for this Welder. How many cards are here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay, we on a weird tangent, we're probably going to wield the Idol of Obstruction because no one values it. I would love to wield Welder. We're going to take the Signet because Signets are good. Gaia's Cradle, LED, Windswept Heath. There is some hotness considering this is so late. Oh, I'm a big fan of Cradle, but it's pretty bad if we're not a creature-heavy deck. We have a Primetime to go grab it. We have a Golos to go grab it. We aren't married to these picks. I'm going to take the Cradle. We aren't necessarily playing the Cradle. Bolus is sitting. Okay, back around, eh? Okay, let's take it. I think the Symbiosis is the better pick, but I could not take that. Do you know what I mean? Nykthos? How big mana can we be? It's better than Whisperwood Elemental. Oh, Whisperwood Elemental is pretty reasonable. It plays well with Gaia's Cradle too. I was about to say it's not that good, but it, as far as 5 drops go, it's pretty damn good. I can't really say it's not. Like, I would cut a lot of 5 drops before that. The fact that it just makes bodies, makes value. Our deck is all over the place, but that's okay, pack one, pick one. Oh, no. Pack 1, pick 1 through 15. Okay, there's a meme that I always shout that green is open and I go into green, but green does appear to be quite open. Right? Was Embry in that pack or was Embry in the next pack? I don't mind being big blue-green mana. That's fine by me. What will we see? Serpent, Ruins, and Beast. Huh. Interesting. I think Questing Beast is pretty good, especially in a format with so many walkers. But I think Stone Cold Serpent's probably better. Primal Command. Okay, yeah, green is open. We'll take Mirari's Wake here, though we probably won't play it. We're going to pop that in our sideboard. Okay, let's see if we open some power, if we open Twin, if we open Tinker. What do we get? No power. So that's... Say it's a shame is an understatement. There's an Avenger of Zendikar, which is mildly exciting. Not the best thing to cheat out. Good thing of big mana. Our Scalding Tarn can currently fetch this Volcanic Garden, which would fix us with more red-blue, but it fetches red-blue already. Savannah would help with Mirari's Wake. This pack is actually really underwhelming, and I'm a bit frustrated by it. I think Lilandra, Archmage, or Volcanic Island are the easy picks. Grizzlebrand if you were in a reanimated deck, but we're nowhere near being in a reanimated deck. Dark Confidant seems bad. Chrome Mox is okay if we had some draw sevens. Preordain is also reasonable. I'm going to take the Volk. I'm going to be absolutely gutted if we end up not being in red. Which is a distinct possibility considering how our deck is lining up right now. But I'm not out of red until we've seen the first seven picks from this pack. I didn't want to be in green. Comment section. Okay. I like being in green. I like green decks. I prefer green decks and unpowered cubes because the mana advantage is bigger, essentially. Next pack. Channel. Okay, Channel. There's a Blightsteel Colossus, which we kind of wouldn't mind to go with the Channel. Simic Signet is also pretty gas for us. We are not a Channel deck at the moment. I mean, Channel Golos. And we've passed an Ulamog already. Consecrated Sphinx, Garrett Relentless. All these cards are reasonable. Frantic Search is pretty good if you've got land attack for more than one mana, like Gaea's Cradle. We're going to take the Channel. We're going to make a pile of cards that the Imperial Recruiter can go grab. Which is just these at the moment. But I mean, they're pretty good cards. Eternal Witness, Thief, and Skydiver. And if you've got the combo, Deceiver Exarch. Okay. Green Sun Zenith. So for 3 green mana, we can go Channel, Green Sun for Primeval Titan. Pretty good. Arid Mesa would fix our mana, but we only have a Volk to go fetch at the moment. Neither of these signets are really in color. Ancestral Visions is reasonable. Through the Breach is reasonable. I think Green Suns is too good to not play. It just grabs us a Primeval Titan, a Whispered Elemental, Eternal Witness. It's got 3 primo targets right now. It does push us further down into green, but I think it's better than most of the stuff there. Vorinclex, how good is Vorinclex in our deck? There's a Pestermite there as well. And an Inferno Titan if we want to be in red. Both, and Frailis is also pretty good. Like all three of these, well, these two are very good. Blowing up artifacts is strong. Making bodies is strong. Drawing cards is strong. I don't know how good Vorinclex actually is in this cube. So I'm going to take... I'm going to Inferno Titan and maybe wheel the Frailis. Yeah. Wheel of Fortune. Crucible. Meh. Fast Bond. Yeah. Time Warp. I am a sucker for a Time Warp. I really am. Factor Fiction and Huntmaster are also pretty good picks from this pack. Can we wheel the Huntmaster? It's a pretty good 4-drop to be able to go and grab with our Green Sun Zenith. We've got Eternal Witness. I think that makes the value of Time Warp a lot higher. I'm going to take Time Warp. Birthing Pod and Corsa. If we're going to wheel that fast bond, which we may well do, Corsa gets a lot better. At the moment, we can pod into Exarch, untap pod, not get a 4-drop. Are we a pod deck? Oh my god, I'm going all over the place. Literally all over the place. Are we a pod deck? We can certainly try to be. We can wheel the Corsa. We got ourselves a Dork there. Not keen on Direfleet. I'm okay with Gilded Lotus, to be fair. Gilded Lotus does allow us to channel into any three colours we need at the end. So we can actually channel into an Inferno Titan from two green mana. I do like the idea of a Land of White Elves, but we can wheel it, I think. I'm going to hit the Gilded Lotus here. Birds of Paradise and Woodfall Primus in this pack. Woodfall Primus makes picking up a Natural Order pretty good, but Natural Ordering for Primeval Titan's not that terrible either. So I'm going to hit the Bird. Gives us a 1-drop and a Mana Fixing Dork. Avenger in our 7-drop slot, so our pod can jump a Primeval Titan into an Avenger is pretty good. Yep, let's go with that. Plowunder, Garrick, or Blightsteel. Now, we do have Channel. Channel Blightsteel is strong, but it's bad against the Plowshares, or even worse against the Path. Well, we'll go for it. Why not? I didn't come here not to. Through the Breach can go well with the Blightsteel and the Prime Time. We wield the Frail Lease. We wield the Huntmaster. Was there another green card I was trying to wheel? What was in the pod with Birthing Pod? Was it Huntmaster in the pack of Birthing Pod? I could do with one more of each drop, right? We could do with another 2-drop, another 4-drop. We need some 5-drop. Oh, and we got 5-drops. I'm literally looking at them. Tons of 5-drops. Wouldn't mind to find, Dryad of Elysian Groves, because it would give us a green sunnable body that can then turn on Golos. That's what I would like to get out of the 3-drop slot in our deck now. Oh, Corsa. Corsa was something I was trying to wheel. I think that might be our last pick or second from last pick. I'm not sold on Through the Breach yet. But I mean, Through the Breaching an Inferno Titan, a Primeval Titan, even an Avenger if we're on 5 or 6 mana, and Blightsteel Colossus, obviously. There's some options here. Also, if we then get Emrakul in pack 3... or any of the other Titans like that. Through the Breaching them or channeling them are both options. So it makes our deck more consistent. And the fact that we have Eternal Witness will allow us to get back something that we have breached. There is another green draft at the table then if we don't get Corsa. Scooze in the same pack as the Elf. Maybe we couldn't get Corsa. It might have been that we didn't have enough of the Corsa. Okay, we have in this pack some real good stuff. Snappy is good with Time Warp, but I think we're only mildly blue. Wooded Hit Foothills gets us the Volcanic Island to fix our mana a little bit better. And then we've got Soul Elf in the 1-drop slot. And we've got Elder Gargaroth. This is rough. I think we can wheel the Tree Speaker, even though it's pretty much one of the primo dorks. But I want to get a bit more fixing so we can actually reliably splash this blue. I don't think we're the Citadel deck anymore, so we can cut that. It pains me to lose that dork. Time Twister. Do we make enough mana to make Time Twister good? We've also got Channel and there's a Khan and a Sundering Titan in this pack. Cultivate is also reasonable. Body and Mind isn't terrible. And Mana Vault's pretty good too. Do we want to Through the Breach of Sundering Titan in our Island Mountain Forest deck? Is another conversation to be had as we pass the Crucible. I think I'm just going to take Khan because we're a channel big mana deck. Again, being a big mana deck means I'm pretty happy to pick up Garrick Wildspeaker here. And then we can wheel the Finale of Devastation. Although Finale of Devastation does give us a way to get Golos and Blightsteel. And it gives us a Crater Hoof style finisher. Nah, I'll take Garrick. Garrick good with Time Warp as well, right? Marsh Flax doesn't fetch us what we need. This gives us extra black off of red fetches, which is not what we need. We've got a Hex Drinker. Hex Drinker is very good. So is Scion of Urza in our channel deck. We can play it on turn one and start making value. It's card draw, and Tribattle fixes us. I'm going to get Khan for card draw here. Do we have another 4-drop yet? We don't. Oracle's a pretty good 4-drop, though. Yeah, I think I'll take Oracle here. I would like Ancient Grudge. Another premium 4-drop, but also a Sylvan Library. I hope I haven't... I've really started to blank on the red cards. I hope I haven't... I really hope I... Ooh, hello. I really hope I haven't dodged We're taking the. Oh. I haven't done Splinter Twin, but do we keep Exarch in for the synergy with the pod? Natural Aura allows us to jump into a Prime Time run Avenger. There's a Tyros tracker there, what I really want, but we take the Natural Order, I think. I doubt we wield the tracker, though. But would we have wielded the Natural Order? That is the question. Next pack. Oh, no. No. What do I do? Comment section. What do I do? Emrakul is better with Through the Breach Channel. Craterhoof is better with Natural Order. Oh no. If we put the Emrakul in our deck, we ditch the Blightsteel Colossus, I think. I think that's what we do. We can wheel the Craterhoof. Green is open. That was the. I rarely ever pass Craterhoofs in draft, especially this late, especially in green. This might be the first time I've ever passed a Craterhoof in green. That hurts. Oh, look at this. Oh, hang on. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Oh, we will see one card in that last pack. Or two cards in that last pack. One card in that last pack. Jiraga Tree Speaker. Do we need another fire drop? We do not. We got the Dork. So green is open. Signal is there. We might be cutting blue entirely. Although I do like Time Warp a lot. But that said, we'd have to cast it off of Birds of Paradise or our blue lands. We didn't get any other fixing. We didn't get a Chromatic Lantern. We didn't get a Coalition Relic. We didn't get a. I think we're just cutting blue. I think we're just cutting blue. Cultivate Sundering Titan. Need some more low ramp. Three drop. We wield the finale. We wield Hextrinket and secure Tribe Elder. Hermit on five. Let's cut the blue now. Casualties of War. A very good Magic card, but we aren't playing it. Didn't wield the Ren in six. Didn't wield the Hoof. This really is the saddest day, isn't it? This really is. The saddest day. There's 32 playable Magic cards there. There's some pretty fun ones too. Some real fun ones. Oh, now it's the time to do the cuts, isn't it? I really don't think we're a Birthing Pod deck. What? I don't even know what a Birthing Pod deck looks like in Cube anymore. I never seem to get there. I'm gonna disappear and come back with a built deck. But if you enjoy this video, hit the like button. Don't forget to drop a comment down below to let me know at which point in the draft you stopped watching. I think our draft was going quite well. Green was very strongly open. It pushed me off of other fun things that I wanted to try. And as far as I can see, we didn't get to Twin. I'm Vince, also known as Pleasant Kenobi on the internet. If you're watching this for pro plays, you've come to the wrong place. But if you are looking to pick up Magic Singles or sealed product, channelfireball.com is your premier place to do so. And when you're doing so, use the code Kenobi at checkout to help support me. Right, I'm back with a built deck in just a moment. Here we are with the finished deck. I've won 17 lands because one of them doesn't make mana without creatures. And we actually don't have that many dorks. We only have like two true fire dorks. We have some ramp spells like Rakdos, Signet, Cultivate, Channel, arguably as well. Obviously, Natural Order and Oracle allows us to jump ahead of mana efficiency and stuff like that as well. The Scaldon Tarn, I considered not playing because it only fetches mountains, but it allows us to fetch and shuffle our deck when we've got an Oracle of Moldiah on top. I've cut most of the red. Huntmaster is just pretty solid as a single red splash. And Through the Breach, we can't actually activate Golos, so I was toying with the idea of cutting it. Three five that gets us Cradle. That might just be good enough. Slightly better than a Solemn in some ways and worse than others. Through the Breach allows us to obviously slam Primeval Titan or Emrakul into play. Now, I cut the Avenger. I cut the Inferno Titan. Maybe we want more things to breach in. We probably want more things to breach in. I'm gonna bring Inferno Titan back in. Make our last cut, probably harmonize them. Skooze in our sideboard for sideboard tech. As is Hexdrinker, if we really need like lower to the ground bodies. That's the deck. Let's play some cube. It's round one. We've won the die roll. We're playing our incredibly fair deck with no power, don't forget. That's another thing I didn't mention during deck building. We didn't get any power. I'm going to keep a Jiraga hand. Especially when we've got a fetch land to get one of our red sources. This Infernotaur is actually quite an ambitious thing to try and cast in our deck composition. Whoopsie. We can't exactly pump it that much either. Forest from our opponent. At least this isn't going to get pushed in response to us pumping it up. It might get stomped on the following turn, maybe. We're going to go Forest, make this guy leveled up. Pass turn back to our opponent. We can Garrick next turn. I guess we should get him for one. Why not? What one mana green flash threats are there that could block? Nothing. I'm unstoppable. They are also the green deck, as it were. Mox Ruby, jeez. Imagine having power. Goblin Rabble, that's aggressive. That's aggressive. So we have 5 mana next turn. Or 4 mana into 3 mana if we play Garrick and untap some lands. With 5 mana, we can go Devastation for a 3 drop. If we draw Gaia's Cradle, it wouldn't do much different. There's a Mountain. Let's crack our taunt. The fact that they're red, I'm scared that my Tree Speaker's going to get killed. That's what I'm scared of here. There's not much we can do here. We have to... we literally have to tap our Tree Speaker. We can't block with it. I'm going to make a Beast with Garrick. We need either Garrick or Tree Speaker to survive to the following turn so we can play a 6-drop. If Infernal Titan would actually clean up the Rabblemaster threat as well. We've got a Finale for a Huntmaster. We'll play a Prime Time. There's a lot of options here. Prime Time getting Gaea's Cradle will be pretty hot. 4 mana here for a Blood Braid. What do you get? Please not a removal spell. Fast Bond. That's potentially far more problematic. They have 4 cards in hand. So at best they can go 3 more lands into a 3-drop. They're going to attack Wild Speaker. They won't attack with a Rabble though, I assume. Or they'll lose the Rabble. Just the Blood Braid? And obviously the Gobbos have got to go in as well. Oh, it all comes in. Okay. We'll just block and clean up the Rabble then. Garrett goes down. We untap and play a Mountain. Then we just slam Inferno Titan. Kill 2 things. Yeah, that's pretty good. It's pretty good. Land from our opponent. Double red. Are we going to see a Glorybringer? Just think you're going to see a Gelder Gargaroth. Okay, that'll draw them cards. I'm okay with them drawing cards, honestly, I think. We're going to go to combat and attack, and we're going to ping down the goblin and shoot them for 2 with the Inferno Titan. I don't mind this here. Two to face, 1 to the Gobbo. And if they block with Gargaroth, they lose the Gargaroth. They'll get a 3-3 beast out of it, or gain 3 life, or draw a card, or whatever. But I'm happy to have Gargaroth off the table. Second main phase, we're just going to slam a Titan. The Titan is pretty strong. We're going to grab Cradle and Foothills here. Accelerating our mana further. Our deck is very... I think our deck is good for a fair deck. It's very good for a very fair deck. There are decks going to do unfair things that's going to ruin us. Excavator, yeah. Maybe we'll just play its fair decks the entire time. So they have unlimited Fast Bond Verdant, like, cracks now. But it costs them 2 life per 1. Birds of Paradise, sure. Sylvan Library, sure. Play the Verdant again, go down to 13. We drew a Witness. Gonna crack our Foothills. grab a forest. Probably we should be playing three mountains, honestly. Go Ewit. Get back the Inferno Titan. And they scoop it up. Inferno Titan was going to bolt down this, then we're going to attack, which is going to love life. That went pretty well. That went pretty well. They are playing a similar deck to us, although they got fast bond synergies. We don't have a Slime or a Vexage effect, which is pretty unusual. With Ramunap, we probably should have Skooze in our arsenal. So I'm going to bring in Skooze. I'm going to cut Finale. Tempted to bring in Primal Command. Allows us to just put Planeswalkers, Fast Bonds, and other very powerful effects back into their library, but okay. Turn one, two library, turn three Dork. This is okay. This is okay. It's a bit slow, honestly, considering they're a Mox Ruby version of our deck. Hex Drinker. Oh, God, that's... Turn one Hex Drinker. Oh, no. It's exactly what we didn't want to see. We untap and we draw a channel. Okay. Would love to draw a Gilded Lotus, then, I guess. Or just an Emrakul. Drawing Emrakul would be pretty strong. A Sylvan Library will obviously help us do those things. They play a Lotus Cobra. They're a Snake Tribal over there. In for two. The more we get hit, the worse channel gets, unfortunately. Drew Forest. Let's go Sylvan Library. We're going to 14 next turn, which means we can't channel into whenever. No, we can play a land and channel into whenever call, right? No, we won't be able to. Tap land from our opponent, making a mana off Lotus Cobra, still gives them 3 mana for the turn, including a red. Is this a Rabmaster? It's a red insect, okay. And a bop. So we take 4 here. We could channel into a Primeval Titan for 6 life. That's a lot of life. They ticked up running 6. We find a mountain off of our Sylvan Library. What else do we find? Huntmaster and a Golos. Not terrible, honestly. So we play a forest and we channel. We're going to pay 5 life for Golos. And then that's going to get us a Cradle. And then we can go Green Suns for X. X equals 6 for Primetime or 4 for Huntmaster. Huntmaster would gain us 2 life and make us another body. I think we do that. So we grab Cradle. We then pay 4. Green Suns for 4. Going to grab a Huntmaster. We'll put us back to 7. Make us another body. And that's the turn. It's not the best. But it's far from the worst. We got 3 attackers. Lotus Cobra, Hex Drinker, and Raging Ravine. Hex Drinker becoming a 6-6 is a problem, but it's going to cost them quite a bit of mana. They're going for it. Okay, 3, 4. Now a 4-4. Next turn I'll be in a 6-6 that we just cannot block. If they don't play any spells, our Huntmaster flips, and they probably don't want that to happen. Put the Verdant back into hand, sure. Continue the level up. So it will be an unblockable 6-6 next turn. Are they going to cast... Are they going to cast Sylvan Library? Okay. We untap and we draw Cultivate and... some lands. Oh, we're dead next turn to a running six tick down, aren't we, actually? Yeah. Hadn't thought of that. 6-6 plus one. Yeah, there ain't much we're doing about that. Even if we attack everything into running six? If we attack everything into running six and they block only the Golos, we get through for four. They can throw the Cobra under the bus though, actually. Yeah, I think that's our only option, is to attack them and see if they block in a way that is not optimal. But then they got this, this, and this. No, we can't win here. Which my opponent would like pass priority for my draw step, because I've just realized that I'm dead and I can't stop it. What do we want to see off that? I guess a way to gain life. Or through the breach. Through the breach would have done a whole lot. Hello, opponent? You maybe they had to step away to help their dog. You okay? I guess it's only frustrating if you're dead on board. If we weren't dead on board, this wouldn't be so frustrating for them just to disappear in my draw step. They could at least disappear in my main phase so I can cast some spells, right? So Cultivate would shuffle our library. It's even between Cultivate and Deranged Hermit this turn, but we are dead to 6 damage from this, protecting from everything, plus 1 damage from Renin 6. We're on 7. Nothing we can do about it. We went a bit too low. The channel line was probably incorrect. But it set us up a lot better. Like, what else were we going to do, you know? So post board, we're gonna bring in. I am gonna bring in the primal command, I think. Yeah, I think primal command is good in this matchup particularly, because it gets us to be able to put things like Renin 6, Sylvan Library and stuff back into the library, or even resetting a Raging Ravine. Maybe our opponent will just time out then. Okay. Maybe they disconnect. I don't think the disconnection message came up. Do I want to harmonize in this match? In the green mirror. The red-green mirror. I'm going to bring in Hex Drinker and Primal Command. I'm going to cut. Draw a blank on what's in our deck. Khan Liberated and something else. Khan's going to come out. One other card. We're going to be a Primary Command Hex Drinker. I never really thought about how good dumping mana into Hex Drinker is in the matchups where they don't really have much removal. Although our Hex Drinker is softer than Renin 6. Like playing Renin 6 on turn 1. Us playing Hex Drinker on turn 1 for them to untap and play a land and play Renin 6 would be pretty bad. Actually, no, I can't bring in Renin 6. Just for the. I know it's only one spell, but it's Renin 6. It's not even like a. It dies to Bolt, right? Which is a 1-for-1 trade. It dies to 1/4 of Renin 6, which is a 2-mana play that they'll play on turn 2 and keep hands off the back of. I don't think Hexdrink is good against like decks that have Renin 6 in it. So I can't bring that in. Sipping some lovely tasty water over there. Had a can of tinny. A tinny is soft. Oh, it's still got some in it. Oh, a tinny of soft soda poppy. Can't get enough of that no soda pop. How long can they go without 1453? That was 6 minutes ago. That was literally 6 minutes ago. How long do they get? 10? Oh, they're back. They're back in time for us to scoop. That is tragic, isn't it? Let's do the attacking thing. Because they don't know we got nothing. Oh, I attacked at him. I attacked at them, not the Renin 6. That was stupid. Right, let's go to sideboarding. I mean, that's what happens when you have 6 minutes to, like, forget what you were doing. That's bound to happen, right? Primal Command in, Whisperwood in, not Hex Drinker in, Khan Liberated out. I don't like Golos in this matchup. If we draw an outlet for the channel, if we draw an Emrakul or a Green Suns or a Finale, we're in a good spot. If we draw some Dorks, we're in a good spot. It feels like if we draw anything except for lands, we're in a good spot. So Library or a Dork would be our best draws, I think. Oh, beautiful. There's the Library. Oh, baby. Oh, baby. This allows us to... This increases our chance of finding either Finale, Green Suns, or Emrakul. Or increase our chance of finding a fetch land to find those things easier in the following turn. What's on top of our library? Let's find out. Through the Breach. Okay. It's always yes, this. Oracle and Through the Breach. Okay. Pay for life. No. Do we want pay for life? Dig deeper? Oracle allows us to dig deeper anyway. It's fine. We're just gonna go forest and pass the turn. Maybe I should have et the Through the Breach into hand for 4 mana. hex drinker. Oh no, my one weakness. And I'm not even joking, it does feel like a weakness. Oh, they're just going for the level up. Okay. Looks like our channel line might be a bit rough again. They missed a land drop. They got six cards in hand, they missed a land drop. That's fine. So top of the library, I threw the bridge, I landed something else. What do we find on top? We should have perhaps put Inferno Titan, eh? Well, we don't really want any of that stuff, if we're honest. We're going to pay four life to put one of them in the hand, but on top. No, I messed that up. We could have kept the forest on top. Play a forest. So we just paid four life for nothing, right? Because I could have... Well, no, the Inferno Titan is in hand. No, I paid for knife for nothing because we could put through the breach forest and put the forest into play. That was incorrect. On the upside, though, Winter Orb is bad for us because untapping this Oracle is difficult. Oh, sorry. No, Oracle makes Winter Orb not so bad because we can find lands. Channel makes it not so bad. We just need to find things on top. Let's have a look at what we find on top. A mountain. Okay, we play the mountain for top. Didn't mess it up this time. We're going to go for two green, channel. We're going to channel five mana. One, two, or four mana. Three, four. Through the breach. Put an Inferno Titan into play. We're going to ping here, ping here, ping here. Because it's only a 2-1 right now. Yeah, it is. We got him. We kill these things. Attack for 6, 9. It gets killed. We've got an Oracle. I say 6. 6 plus 2 is 8, plus 3 is 11. 11 takes them to 9. They're untapped and get to untap one land plus the Signet. Which, to be honest, means the 7th of the game. Land plus Signet. And we're untapping only one land. But I guess not our opponent disconnected. Probably for the second time ever. That was pretty good. Let's see how next round goes. It is round 2. We have a Cultivate. But it's lands and spells. It's lands and spells. It's slow, and our deck is already, inverted commas, slow because it doesn't do anything degenerate on the early turns. Maybe we'll just draw a channel at some point. Ancestral Recall in my turn to draw 3. For those that don't know, the reason our opponent did that is so they didn't have to discard at end of turn. We're going to start with a forest in case we draw a channel on turn 2. Fetching with the Scalding Tundra thin our deck is not a bad thing, but we want to just not draw... to be able to cast channel if we draw it, so we can go card liberated into blow up land. Okay, so they've drawn 3 more cards on this. Recall's a pretty good magic card. I don't know if you've heard how good Recall actually is. It's really good. I'd say it's in my top 9, perhaps. I don't know if anyone's ever really gone into great detail about that, you know? The most powerful 9 magic cards ever printed. The funny thing is, the most powerful 9 cards of magic ever printed wouldn't even include all the power 9. That's the funny thing. Recall would definitely make it, but like Time Twister ain't as good as isn't as good as Sol Ring, for example, or I guess Bazaar and Workshop and I guess Library of Alexandria, but Library isn't that great. There's a Rakdos Signet. Imagine if they played Krark and then flipped a coin. And if it fails, it goes back to hand. If they win, it goes doubled? Huh. I have not played with Krark or against Krark in Commander, nor in this. And I played quite a bit of like a little bit of Commander Legends Limited online, a little bit via webcam. I played a boxing league on the CFB Discord and all that sort of jazz. And I have yet to see a Krark Thumbless. And it seems like the kind of commander that people would build around, right? But I've hardly ever seen anyone play him. Mountain from our opponent, 3 mana. This is going to be a Tireless Tracker. They're doing very fair things here, so I'm okay with it. We're going to get attacked for 2. We untap and we draw a Gilded Lotus. Okay, so we'd be ramping. We'd be ramping. 3 mana. Let's just go Cultivate. We're going to grab a Mountain and a Mountain. I'm going to put a mountain into play. And then I guess next turn we'll just cast a Titan. And then we'll cast a Khan. And this Guild Lotus basically just never really does anything because we're going to have other stuff. Gaia's Cradle. Slightly less fair magic now. Secure Tribe Elder. Not that degenerate. Sack the Elder. Pay three off the Gaia's Cradle first. Or make three off the Gaia's Cradle first. Get some lands. Crack some clues. Is that what we're going to see? No, just a Bloodbraid. Not bad. Into a Wall of Roots. Makes their Cradle pretty good. Makes their Cradle pretty good. We get attacked for a whole bunch here. We get attacked for like... what's that? A million? Eight. That's a lot. That's a lot. We untap and we draw a Stone Cold Serpent. So we get a Mountain. Five, six mana. Just play a Titan, right? Like... yeah. We could Finale for four. Just not as good. Shoot the Tracker for two, then for one... they can only make one mana off the Wall of Roots, so they couldn't grow the Tracker. We're on 10. They have four cards in hand. Two clues in play. And access to a Gaia's Cradle. I am terrified. If they cast something like a Plow Under or a Primal Command or any good powerful instant or sorcery. I mean, there's a lot of good blue and red ones. Even, I guess, a Braid or Bolt could be crocked into a back-breaking thing. White, red, and green. Mirari's Wake? No. This. Wow. It just draws you four cards. Which in this case... okay, our opponent's got Fast Bond, Ancestral Vision, Time Walk, and Ancestral Recall, and a Wheel of Fortune. Their deck is literally insane. This is why I kind of hate Vintage Cube. Because we didn't see... We saw Wheel of Fortune. But we didn't see this... all this. So I guess we did see a Fast Bond, but I don't even think Fast Bond's power. It's just better than most. Not better than most. It's stronger than most. Oh my god, double Time Walk. Okay, that's enough. Well, we should probably see what's in the deck. Oh, no, that's enough. We've seen enough. Let's take two extra turns. They got a Wheel of Fortune to cast in the next turn, so they draw seven, then the following turn, and so on. I just can't be bothered with it. We got absolutely dumpstered. Not even remotely close. I'm assuming they got more power, so I'm going to... oh no, we didn't play blue in the end, did we? I can't bring on my Skydiver. Primal Command. Maybe we can keep up with their recall by paying four mana to draw the same number of cards at sorcery speed. I kind of want to eat stuff out of their bin in case they can recur the Time Walk. But I'm not going to. Golos Cavern Gaia's Cradle is fine, but it's not that good in our deck, so I'm cutting the Golos. We'll turn two, channel Emrakul. It's pretty good. I've got channel Emrakul and put a Titan into play through the Breach if we draw a Titan. Which we won't, but... draw a Tree Speaker. Okay, let's go green, cast channel. They're F6, I think we're okay. Well, I guess even if you've got all the power spells in the world, I mean, channel is close. Channel is a card that, again, you don't get in Legacy Cube. It's a powered cube staple. 14... cast an Emrakul, always yield. We're gonna crack this Golden Tarn going to four. Grab a mountain. Next time we untap, we draw an Inferno Titan. Interesting. Let's level this up. I know I'm just going through the motions here, but they might do something to not die. I don't know what it'd be, but they're gonna lose both their land and their Fast Bond here. Resetting them back to one land, doing 15 damage, and they go to five. If they untap and go like one mana, kill us down from four. No. Okay, channel Emrakul. Not quite as iconic as channel Fireball, but channel Emrakul was pretty good. Okay, we're just going to run it back. Hopefully we have a similar situation. This hand is slow. Turn two, bird. Turn three, do nothing. Yeah, I think we have to mulligan this. If this was turn two bird and like something before five, I'll be okay with it. We're gonna mulligan this. This is better, but not much. We're gonna bottom the Titan, I guess. The red Titan, not the green Titan, obviously. This puts us to three mana. One more land enables natural order. We need a body before then. We've got mana dorks that can enable it. Natural order will go get us what though? Normally primeval Titan, so it'll go get us. Not Whisperwood. It won't get us much, honestly. Maybe I bottom the natural order. Maybe I bottom the primeval Titan. That's an interesting one. Actually, no, because we can go get like Eternal Witness to bring back the natural order to hand, or there's got to be something else. I'm blanking on what our five drops were. I'd love to draw Birds of Paradise. That'd be hot. No, we drew the E-Whip, so this natural order is looking significantly worse. They're just three color stuff. It looks like just all these power cards, and then okay, we're gonna get a library to make sure we hit our next land drop. It puts us back a mana because of the Signet, but we risk just not drawing a land next turn. Where library means that's just very unlikely as we get to see three cards deep. Soulfire Grandmaster to be able to replay the Tome Walks. Yeah, they are just good stuff, deck plus power. Okay, they probably got Mystic Sanctuary in their deck to get the Tome Walk back, but just like only three islands total or something, and they'll probably manage it. I'm not feeling confident considering their start. Okay. We get hit for two. They only have one forest in play for this knight as well. We found a land. What else did we find? Another land. We can Through the Breach the Primeval Titan shortly then. Okay. Put on top. Put on top. Kind of wish we kept the Inferno Titan. Breaching an Inferno Titan would be a lot hotter, honestly. The Primeval Titan will find us Gaea's Crater on a land, then die, and then we'll be just keep getting twatted in the face by these two twos or soon to be three threes. Maybe the correct thing to do is slam Frail, at least make a body. Make them fight me over it. Attack for four here. No, only for three with Exalted, and they're gonna use the knight to change that forest to a guy's code next one and give them literally 1,000 mana. Stonecall Serpent on top. We'll have to pay for life if we want to put the Titan into play, so we're not going to do that. Make a Frail Elise, Llanowar's furry. On weekend, she dresses up like a lion. Make an elf druid. We've got Avenger in our sideboard, haven't we? Yeah. Maybe we should be playing it. But that's the problem with Cube. You always draft so many good cards that maybe you should be playing everything, I guess. Keeping the elf druid alive as well, which allows us to just cast the Primeval Titan. They didn't fetch a Gaea's Cradle off the Green Forest, which is was probably categorically not correct. They're now gonna copy the next spell they cast. Crack this, grab a blue. No, grab a forest. Blue forest. Make two time walks. Okay. Oh no, not two time walks away. Put it back in their hand. And now they have. Well, there's a good chance what will happen here is that they will just get to do that forever and now we're locked out of the game. Soulfire Grandmaster plus time walk and six mana is pretty insane. One, two, three, four, five, six. And they should have six again in case. Unless this can't fetch. Well, it costs a Gaea's Cradle, can't it? Nah, it's game over. Like, even if they can't do it the following turn somehow. So, four to activate, sack this. Does this get a non-forest? That gets us out of the loop if they just somehow don't draw enough lands. No. Okay, they get at least another loop. I'm gonna scoop it then and go next round. I have seen enough. You got the loop. GG. Okay, look, we don't have any power, but we won the die roll. This is basically power. Like, We have Jiraga Tree Speaker. Jiraga Tree Speaker is the real power, right? Soul Elf is Soul Elf. And if Soul Ring is better than most Power 9, then Soul Elf, in a world where creatures matter, and creatures are getting pushed more and more and more, Soul Elf must be pretty good. That's how this works, right? If they kill my Jiraga Tree Speaker, I'll be very, very sad. If they don't, we're going to have tons of mana. Like tons and tons and tons and tons and tons of mana. Could be great. I say tons of mana. We'll have two next turn for the Soul Ring. For the Soul Ring? For the Signet. Imagine getting a Soul Ring. Imagine opening power. I moan about every time I don't, and then when I do, I lose anyway. So it doesn't really matter, does it? We're going to pass to our opponent after playing our Soul Elf. Very legacy cube opening for Vintage Cube there. Well, don't just like go mox, punch me in the bum hole. Ancient Tomb, 2-mana Revoker, Name Tree Speaker, I assume. We don't have a Rexage, we don't have an Acidic Slime. We are missing that fundamental part of this sort of toolbox, essentially. I think with Vintage Cube, you kind of have to look at things as collections of cards. Like our last round opponent, for example, with their fantastic collection of just tons of power. But also like the Knight plus the Gaia's Cradle. The Grand Fire Soul Master take a turn, lol. That spell. You gotta think of cards as like suites or combinations, combos almost. Synergistic houses. And Green Suns plus a Rexage is one of them, or Green Suns plus a Knight of one, or Green Suns plus Acidic Slime. Although, if we had a slime here, if we could Green Suns a slime here, I'd blow up the tomb, wouldn't I? Because I'm like that. Thoughtseize, strong magic card. Good job, we got an Eternal Witness. I doubt they take the Dork, I assume they take the Green Suns, or maybe the Finale because it's more versatile. Also, they might be thinking that we're going to Green Suns or Finale for our Rexage next turn, like we have access to it or something. We don't. They took the Green Suns because Green Suns triples back in as well. Green Suns is better for many ways. We can Ewit that back. We'll take two here. We untap, we draw a forest. Sure. We're going to go attacking. And then we're going to play a bird, and hopefully we can then use the bird to Finale for something good next turn. Now, I guess a Huntmaster of the Fells could kill a Jiraga Tree Speaking named Phyrexian Revoker. Not a Revoker called the Jiraga Tree Speaker. If someone gave birth to a Phyrexian Revoker, well, firstly, they'd be terrified. Can you imagine that coming out of your vagina? But secondly, if they then named it Jiraga Tree Speaker, like, if you had a baby that was a Revoker and you named it any other magic card, like, even just called it Liliana, you're asking for trouble. Like, they'd be like, what's named that Revoker? And then someone mishears them slightly, like, Liliana. And then they think they can't enter the Liliana. Do you know where I'm going with this? I don't. They pay 3 mana, they hit themselves for 2, going down to 12. What have they got? Hopefully not a Collective Brutality on our bird or anything. That'd be sad. Or Heartless. Heartless Act? That's in the cube, right? If we're on Twitch right now, I would exclaim card it. But we can't. Dismember, maybe? Because they are taking a long time to put this mana into it. It is Brutality. Had the Soul Read. We're going to lose our bird, lose our Finale. And that puts us in top deck mode. We're against Phyrexian Revoker Jund here. And they discard a Stoneforge Mystic, which is interesting. Shock themselves off the grave, play a 2-mana spell? Yes, interesting. Bitter Blossom, they're only on 10. I am into it. Revoker comes in, I assume. No. Cowardice. Huntmaster. Well. Let's get into the red zone. In goes our 1-1. Will they trade it for the 2-1? Which then unlocks the Jiraga Tree Speaker, but also kills the Jiraga Tree Speaker. Such is the duality of Jiraga Tree Speakers. They go to 9 here. This is important because Bitter Blossom will ping them down every turn. The Ancient Tomb Bitter Blossom deck is an ambitious one. I will not lie to you. Let's make red-black here. two green. Pretend we got Bolt. We got empty hands, and we don't have Bolt, but we go up two and make a 2/2. Unless they force this or something with their final two cards, but we don't mind that. I'd rather they didn't, but that would be two cards out of their hand, and they would go to 8. I'd rather give them two going to 19 and make two bodies, honestly. This also incentivizes them to cast spells. Those spells might cast them, cost them health of Ancient Tomb. If they don't cast it, we get to kill a Revoker, make a 4/4 trample. I just love life. Okay, they go to 6. Choop choops. Yeah, choopy choops. Sure thing, choopy choops. I can dig it. Why is it, hey, dig it? I'm upset. I'm actually devastated. But we still have 5 mana. Delta means they're on a virtual 5, they crack it. We drew a forest. We're just going to play it. We're going to not attack here. I don't want to trade my 2/2 for their 2/2. Yeah. Well, do I? No, I don't. Because if we draw a cradle, it's more mana to have bodies as well. There are reasons to have the wolf in play. They go to 5. At the moment, just letting them die to Bitter Blossom is a very real possibility. They can attack us for 1 here with a rogue. Next turn is 2. So that's 3 total. Turn after is 3, which is 6. So 3 turns 6. Another 4 on the following turn. That's 10 on turn 4. And on turn 5, they die. So I'm feeling pretty good about stuff. I'm going to trade the wolf for the troops to conserve our life total. We drew an Oracle of Moldiah, which, whilst not amazing, is good if we have like 2 lands on top of our deck to just get through our deck. Forest. Mountain. Then we'll draw our Golos next turn, which is just terrible and I shouldn't be playing it, but that's not the point. We will attack here freely. It can either kill a fairy or a revoker, lessening the clock on us, or take them to 4, lessening the clock on, well, increasing the clock on them. Fairy for derogatory speaker, I'm fine with that. The Golos also gives us a chance to shuffle our library as well, so we can manipulate our next draw that we know we'll be getting thanks to the Oracle. They go to 4 here. They can hit us for 3. That's fine. I won't be trading my Oracle for a Phyrexia Revoker anytime soon. They crack my Delta going to 3. That changes the math significantly as well, unless they play an incredibly powerful 5 or 6 drop. Oh no. Looks like I lose then. Oh my god, why did they not equip it there? What the hell? I guess going to 1 would be very bad. They do not want to do that. That would be god awful. Okay, interesting. We draw a Golos. There's a natural order on top, which we do not want. Or do we? Probably not. We're going to play Golos. We're going to thin our deck out. Grabbing a cradle. Playing a forest. Finding a answer to the Sword of Fire and Ice on top of our library. So that's quite nice. I mean, we could blow up the Bitter Blossom if we were feeling like, you know, friendly. We're not. We're just going to kill that Fire and Ice and let them die to their own fairies. And obviously, the Fire and Ice will hit us. It will kill the Oracle. It will shoot us for 2. And it will draw them another card as well, which is important. On the upside, Fairies is on top of our library and not in our hands. We can't randomly be disrupted. Thief of Sanity. Okay, okay. That is a magic card. That can get them cards off our library. Luckily, we have no ways to kill Bitter Blossom in our deck. Other than Freyalis. So they didn't equip the Fire and Ice this time. Because... Okay. Interesting. Interesting. Imagine if they thiefed last turn. Hit us this turn. Got off Freyalis and blown up their own Bitter Blossom. That would have been... rough. That would have been rough. Okay, they scoop it up. We got that. So they were on 2, we were on 18. Bitter Blossom's going to kill them. Sweet, 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 sweet. We know they got a Fire and Ice. I'm going to bring in Primal Command again. I'm going to cut Golos. It was bad there, and it's just bad in general. We shouldn't be playing it. The cradle isn't impactful enough because we don't have enough top end, I guess. It's the argument. I mean, it's fine with channel. And by fine, I mean maybe just below fine, honestly. Might bring the Skooze if we end up racing them. And cut Natural Order. It's good for an early Titan, but besides that, it's bad. And as you saw there, we had hands that had Titan and it in hand. And that's bad. Not good, but bad. Our opponent's sideboarding for a longer time than us, which always scares me. I'm like, what on earth could they have? Like a boat? Could they have a boat? I hope they don't have a boat. If it's a pirate ship, I'm okay with them playing that, but if it's a console flagship, then I don't want them to cast that off their engine too early. That'd be rough. I've got my Time Spiral remastered packs next to me for the release party. That probably would have happened by the time this video comes out this weekend. I'm taking all my might not just to rip them open and see what I get. This is pretty reasonable. This is Reach. It's actually pretty good against the fateful Bitter Blossom. Even just a 2/2. Tubes can kill it though. This is effectively a 2 lander. Serpent does turn on the Zenith. Green Suns can get us a bird. Oracle or draw us cards. Inferno Titan's very good at cleaning up Bitter Blossom tokens and threatening the person's life total who has now took damage to the Bitter Blossom. That's nice. Nothing from our opponent on turn one. We draw a deranged hermit. We pass the turn back to our opponent. Did they thought seize us last turn? No, they thought seized and they did the whole two mana collective brutality thing, wasn't it? Yeah. Let's go Green Suns for birds, which will probably die to a push, but that's fine. It's okay. It's not the worst. Jiraga, Tree Speaker, or Birds of Paradise. Let's get Tree Speaker. This way they might think, oh, we're just going to revoke it instead, and then we still get the Cradle Act out of it. Okay, Heartless Act, there we go. Which doesn't kill it once we've got a level up counter on it, interestingly. It does remove the level up counters, though. That's an interesting interaction, I'd say. Revoker naming... What were they randomly named? Rakdos Signet? In some ways, getting that Jiraga Tree Speaker was good there, because they could have just blind named Jiraga Tree Speaker. We got Bird. Raphelos. Well, good job we ain't playing Raphelos then. We'd love to hit a land drop here. We did not. We drew Green Suns, though, so I guess we can just go Green Suns for a Bird. It shuffles back in, you see. So if we had that the other way around, that would have been quite painful. As in, they would have killed our Birds of Paradise, probably blind named Jiraga Tree Speaker, and then we would have felt really bad about life. They didn't push our bird in end step. They are going to play a Chups here, though? No, a Gonti. Okay. If we draw a land, we can play Deranged Hermit. Or Frailes. They're going to get a card off of us from Gonti. What could they get that's really like not good for us? I guess if they just prime time us, that would be sad. That'd be very sad, let's be honest. If we draw a mountain, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. No, we need to draw edge. Any land would be good. Any land would be good. That is not a land, but it's basically a land. I don't play the Oracle and we'll die, though. Let's hit land drops. It's fine. Sylvan Library is very good with Oracle of Moldiah when you do it properly, not like we did in round one. I'm going to pass back to our opponent. We're not on a huge amount of threat. They can attack us for another 4 next turn, taking us 14. I'm always scared of what Gonti has got them, not just because my deck is so powerful, but I don't know. People also look at the backbreaking stuff. Like, someone can draw 3 cards of Ancestral Recall, and you're like, fine, we can still come back from that. They get 1 card out of your deck with Gonti, and you're like, no, it's game over. They've obviously got our best cards. There's no two ways about it. Attack for 4. Yep, no blocks over here, my friend. You do you, my friend. We get to untap, we draw Sylvan Library, we play a forest, we find a Huntmaster of the Fells on top of our library. We have 2, 3, 4. So we have 3 plus 2 is 5, plus bird is 6. We can go Garrick Wildspeaker, make a big serpent. Not great. We can go Garrick Wildspeaker, make a Sylvan Library. Also fine. Make a Garrick. Down tick Garrick. Make 3 mana, make a Sylvan Library. Okay, we're setting up. A Deranged Hermit would have been pretty good for just making a million mana, but I don't think that's where we want to be. We're not going to block with the Oracle of Moldiah. We're just going to throw it under the bus. They'll have to take both things. I'll happily block a Gonti with a Beast. Trade 1 for 1 with the Garrick, because the Roker will kill it. Actually, maybe that wasn't the best line considering the current board state, actually, come to think of it. 7 mana Karn liberated. Exile our library. I think attacking Garrick with both creatures and exile the library is the best line here, personally. They could kill our bird to take us off red, knowing that Huntmaster's on top. That's another line. Exile the Cradle. That is also pretty reasonable, to be honest. And that does shut us down a little bit, too. No attacks. Interesting. Okay, library triggers. Always yes. Emrakul, which we're not casting for a while. So we're going to put that on top of our library. Put this on top of our library. I'm going to play the forest. I'm going to play a Fraelis. I'm going to down tick to destroy the Revoker. We need to threaten this Karn. Going to go to combat and attack the Karn. He's not an artifact right now. For a moment, I thought he's gone. Are the Aetherborn artifacts? And I just completely brain farted. The beast gets killed here by the Death Touching Gonti if they block. If not, they just lose the Karn. I'm happy for either. Killing the Gonti, by the way, doesn't stop you from being able to cast the card they've exiled. They can cast that no matter what anyway. So they should 100% block here, yeah. That makes perfect sense. They can only uptick to exile 1 more permanent next turn. We're just going to make another beast. They've drawn their one card for the turn, so they got card activation and one unknown card, and of course, that is Archon Liberator, I've just realised. That's the card they got off Gonti. Interesting. I didn't realise that until just this moment. I was thinking, oh, they have one more card off Gonti. They don't. They've already cast it. So if they uptick, I guess I throw away the Inferno Titans. I can't cast it. Well, that's pretty good if I do cast it, isn't it? So probably, and I'll put Sylvan Library's helping us find that lot. Second Red Source too. Maybe it's the Stone Cold Serpent or the Deranged Hermit then. Oh, let's just go. Let's exile Stone Cold Serpent. Let's do that. Scrub land for my opponents. They drew a land. We untap and we activate Sylvan Library. Through the bridge on top, channel on top. So we can channel and then cast the Ember Call for 13 plus 2, don't we? We just threw the Breach the Ember Call next turn. That seems good. So we have to keep the Ember Call in hand and then throw the Breach the next card. We're going to go with Huntmaster. Make a body. Then we're going to make a body. Then we're going to untap some lands. I'm having fun. Are you having fun, opponent? I'm having fun. Go to combat and attack the Khan Liberated to avoid it from downticking and killing our bird. I don't know if they saw the through, though they would have seen the through the breach. They could have seen it. So we take them down to two and they can only uptick. We'll throw the Deranged Hermit into the Khan uptick because both Inferno Titan and Emrakul are pretty good with the coming through the breach. They cast a aggressive 3-1. They're trying to be like aggressive Esper, I guess. Deranged Hermit into the bin. Off it goes. We're on 16. We could just channel the Emrakul now. Yeah, we're going to channel it. Yeah, we're going to channel it. Make a body. Untap two lands. These two here. Make a load of mana. Six. And then we're just going to pay the other. What's that? We need another nine. Tappy, tap, tap, tap. Activate, activate. Lose life, lose life, lose life. Cast an Emrakul. Emrakul resolves. We'll go to combat and attack with just the beast, I guess, at them. I'm okay with that. They're dead, right? They have no cards in hand. They'll get another turn. I'm going to throw the breach to the Inferno Titan as well to really hammer it home. Taking extra turns is strong. Just cost me tons of life. My opponent did a blue and one. Try harder. Try having a time warp on a 15-15. 15 mana is actually a very little for an Emrakul, right? Considering all the stuff. It should probably be 20 or 30 mana. We We untap and we draw some stuff with Sylvan Library. We're going to put on top, pay for life, play a Foothills, crack the Foothills, go to two here, grab a Mountain, shuffling our library. We don't find any more lands for our Oracle on top. We're going to then through the Breach, our Inferno Titan, who's going to shoot you for three. We're going to untap two lands because I'm having the time of my life over here. We're going to make a 1-1. And then we're going to go to combat and attack them. Their face, nothing else. Because they die. Oh, no. Reset. Attack with all creatures at their face. I almost did the opposite of what I did earlier. In they go. Annihilate it. Inferno Titan trigger. We're going to shoot you for three. We could have killed Khan here with the Inferno Titan shots, which would be more comprehensive, I guess. They pay two life here. Yep. And they scoop it up. We got there with a 2-1. Our deck was good. It was just too fair to realistically and reliably go 3-0 in Vintage Cube because everyone's doing dumb stuff. I've been Vintage Snow's Plastic Club on the internet. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, smash that like button. Don't forget to subscribe as well. And check me out on youtube.com/PleasantKenobi and twitch.tv/PleasantKenobi, where I do loads of magic content and the occasional bit of Warhammer content too. And if this comes out after the weekend, I streamed some D&D over the weekend. So check for that stuff out on my Twitch and my YouTube as well. Ta-ta for now, everybody. Ta-ta for now.